So it's no secret I'm a big fan of animation. And if I come across an animated show I like, it usually holds a special place in my heart. And I've come across quite a few animated shows that I absolutely adore. Unfortunately, very few animated shows are perfect, which is why today, I'm counting down a few episodes from great cartoons that were just horrible. Now I'll address the elephant in the room. Phantom Strider already did a list like this. But you don't need to worry, because I'm setting a few rules that will guarantee my list is almost completely different from his. First off, I'm only allowed to put two episodes that were on his list onto my list. Second, I can't put episodes from shows that I've already made worse lists on. So, no episodes from Family Guy, Futurama, South Park, and of course, SpongeBob, pre or post movie. Third, I'm disqualifying episodes from Ed, Edd n Eddy because I kinda have something else planned for the terrible episodes from that show. Fourth, there are a few great cartoon shows out there that I still haven't seen, like Steven Universe and Avatar The Last Airbender, so I won't be including any terrible episodes from those shows. And finally, only one episode per cartoon show, which means I'll need to scrape the bottom of the barrel a bit. In fact, the first few episodes on this list, I don't even find that bad. Just bad by the standards of the show they're in. Oh well, that's the price of being a critic. Anyway, that's about it. So let's count down the worst episodes of some of the best cartoon shows ever. Every dog has its day from Teen Titans Go. Wait, Teen Titans Go isn't a good show? Why'd I put one of their episodes on this list? Oh wait, this isn't Teen Titans Go. This is regular Teen Titans. Uh-oh. Oh boy, this is gonna be rough. Well, first of all, I said I had to scrape the bottom of the barrel, and this is about as bottom as it gets for good shows that have bad episodes. Now, while I'm not sure if every Teen Titans fan would consider this the worst episode of the series, I think most would agree it's a pretty forgettable episode, all things considered. This episode is about Beast Boy wanting to hang out with someone, but all the Titans are busy. So he goes into town and tries to get a few girls to like him by pretending to be a dog. But after they reject him too, he wanders off alone, and honestly, it's just depressing to watch. While an alien dog who showed up at the start of the episode runs into Beast Boy, and then Beast Boy gets taken into an alien ship, which, for the sake of the plot, doesn't take his communicator. And inside this ship is a rock alien that thinks Beast Boy is his dog. And this rock alien is fucking obnoxious. He's literally just a big bratty child. And he keeps zapping Beast Boy every time he wants Beast Boy to change.
Change! Change!
Yeah, it's nothing more than an episode that just shits all over Beast Boy. And aside from that, nothing really goes on in this episode. Well, there is a somewhat amusing side plot where the Titans find the green alien dog and assume it's Beast Boy, and some mildly entertaining humor does occur from this. But it's nowhere near good enough to save this whole episode. Now, I wouldn't call this episode unwatchable. Far from it, I'd consider it a C- episode. But that's why it's on this list. It's a C- episode in a series that's filled with A and B episodes. So, by default, it's, in my opinion, the worst episode of this series. But hey, really, if this is the absolute worst this show could do, it's easy to see why it's still very loved even today.
Beast Boy? Aren't you coming?
Thanks. But if it's cool with you guys, I've kinda had enough attention for one day.
King Tuck from Danny Phantom. I'm a huge fan of Danny Phantom, but there were a few episodes that weren't all that good, and King Tuck is probably the worst of those episodes. It's just so forgettable and so boring. This episode is about Tucker running for student body, but no one wants to listen to him.
How can I run a campaign for student council president when nobody's listening to me?
Yeah, this is basically the whole theme of this episode. Tucker suddenly becomes mute to everyone, and even Danny and Sam stop listening to him. And it gets old and worn out so fast. In fact, let's count how many times they use this joke in just the first 2 minutes.
What was that? Did you say something? Hi, I'm Tucker. And what's it take to get listened to around here? Listen, not now, Tucker. I'm busy writing in your voice.
Wow, I never saw that coming.
I did. Well, geez, Tuck, why didn't you say something?
Well, while the class is on a field trip to the museum, they visit a display for a pharaoh who looks identical to Tucker. And Lancer reveals that the pharaoh had a minion who was very loyal to the pharaoh, and this minion would reappear when the image of the pharaoh was cast into his mirror. Yeah, that doesn't sound forced at all. And as expected, Tucker looks into the mirror, and the minion appears and pledges his allegiance to Tucker, which makes him the only character that'll listen to Tucker in this whole episode. And this minion gives him a possessed scepter that belonged to the pharaoh, and Tucker becomes mad with power as a result. And it's clear the episode wants you to hope that Tucker will be stopped, but it's kind of satisfying, because up until this point, he was getting treated horribly. Not just by the other students, but by Danny and Sam as well. So when he becomes a dictator, you kind of side more with him. Hell, even when Danny tries to stop him, he doesn't once actually listen to him. The episode at least picks up a bit when Tucker transports them to Egypt. But they do this so late into the episode that they can't really do much with it. It just results in Tucker enslaving the students for like 2 seconds, and Danny freeing him and then giving a very half-hearted apology for how he treated him.
It might listen to you.
Somebody should've.
I know, and I'm sorry.
That just feels like an apology you give when you're saying sorry just to make the person happy, not because you're actually sorry. And it of course ends with Tucker still getting the snot beat out of him because, you know, gotta get one more didn't listen joke in, but with a sprinkle of undeserved torture humor this time.
Do you just call us handmaidens?
And why do I feel like I know what your feet smell like?
Stupid scepter. I specifically asked for a total mind wipe. Why doesn't anyone listen?
Yeah, this is just a lazy episode. I mean, it's clearly filler, it's boring, it's kind of predictable, and everyone acts very out of character. But despite all that, it's still not one of the worst things I've ever seen. It's just one of the worst things to ever come out of Danny Phantom. Sweet and Sour from the Powerpuff Girls. Alright, look. Season 5 of this show had quite a few bad episodes, and this is one of the worst from that season. It's about a bunch of cute baby animals committing crimes, and when the girls try to stop them, they get met with this.
I've never seen such unnecessary brutality in my life!
Shame on you! There's not a contract in your
body! Yeah, the townspeople are fucking assholes. They are so willing to turn on the Powerpuff Girls just because these animals are precious. They're not even all that precious. The cat in Kathmandu is cuter than these things. And that one still had to hypnotize the professor to get him to do what he wanted. Also, these animals are fucking annoying.
Listen here, you bug-eyed creeps. We won't last 1 minute in that jail.
Yeah, not with our cute little faces.
Yeah, I just wanted to see the girls drop them on their precious little heads. And this is basically the whole episode. The girls get a call that a crime is being committed, try and do their job, get scolded by the townspeople and the damn narrator, even though they were called there to do their jobs, bitch about it, and then the cycle just keeps on repeating. It's just so tedious, and it's not even remotely entertaining. That is, until the end, when the girls actually come up with a clever way of stopping them, when they trick the animals into going to their school, where they're ambushed by rough children. That somewhat saves this episode. Even though the girls never get an apology from the townspeople. Hell, even the narrator gets this annoying final jab in.
Too bad the day was saved by the Powerpuff Girls, because they were so cute and furry and snuggly and huggable.
Also, how the hell were the townspeople so ungodly affected by their cuteness, yet none of the girls seem affected? I mean, yeah, Bubbles has a moment where she's infatuated with them, but it only lasts for a few seconds. And Bubbles is pretty damn weak-willed. And again, it's not like Kathmandu, where the professor had an excuse to do what he did. He was actually hypnotized. These townspeople aren't. They're doing this willingly, and that just makes it even worse. That being said, I do put this episode a bit low as well, because, well, truthfully, this wouldn't have even been my first choice. I would have gone with either Sunscream or Girls Gone Mild. But I chose this one because it hadn't really been talked about much. And I guess I could see people forgiving this episode because of the ending. Also, I do give this episode a little bit of credit for making the animals voiced by the same voice actresses that voiced the Powerpuff Girls. It's actually quite clever. So, that keeps this episode from being unwatchable. But, it's still a very hard episode to watch without leaving feeling unsatisfied. Sore Eyes from Dexter's Lab. Dexter's Lab is another show that's really hard to find a terrible episode in. I mean, the dad short with the dad doing nothing but this for like 4 minutes is by far the worst thing in the show. But it's a bit hard to get material out of something like this now, isn't it? Yeah, I thought so. This episode, while I wouldn't say is infuriating, it's pretty gross. It's about Dexter giving himself laser eye surgery and being able to see things in HD. Which, while probably making you a bit squeamish if you're very sensitive to eye surgery humor, is at first pretty cool. Dexter sees the world in a claymation-like perspective and can see things no one can see with the naked eye. Hell, there's even a Samurai Jack Easter egg in there! That's pretty awesome! It's honestly a nice little scene. That is, until he sees the humans, and the HD vision turns into HD from Family Guy vision.
Dad, do you notice anything different about the new...
Good morning. Breakfast.
Ugh, that's gross. Really, it's just an entire episode of looking at disgusting imagery. It's the face freeze of Dexter's laboratory. But it's not just the humans who look disgusting. Dexter's eyesight is so good that he can actually see the germs and tiny funguses in his food, which leads to even more disgusting humor when his dad decides to eat the food for him.
I'll eat it.
And you can tell it relies so heavily on this gross-out stuff, because the rest of the writing is just... nuts! I don't even know what to make of it. For example, when Dee Dee comes down and wants to show off a new trick. And no, I don't mean the trick where she somehow shrinks Dexter. Seriously, look how small he is compared to her. It's... this. What is this? Even if it wasn't in HD, what exactly is she doing? Oh, and Dad and Mom join in too. Mom at least blows raspberries, but Dad, I guess, is just blowing his nose. Oh, and we can't go without the lovely extreme close-ups. Well, Dexter wants to know how bad he looks if everyone else looks this hideous in HD. And even his reveal makes no sense.
I, Dexter Boy Genius, am still a vision of loveliness.
Okay, at least the rest of the family I understood. Dexter was seeing all of their flaws at the absolute max, so they looked like deformed humans. So why is Dexter an octopus? I don't know, this episode is just weird, even for Dexter's laboratory. But again, even though this is a repulsive episode, I could certainly see the humor in it. It's clearly more for people who enjoy disgusting humor, and I'm just not one of them. So, it didn't feel fair to rank this episode any higher. But, it really is a bottom-dwelling Dexter's Laboratory episode.
That's nothing! Look at me!
Oh, that's charming.
Revenge from Courage the Cowardly Dog. Wait, a Courage episode? Now why'd I put this on here? Hell, I even like this idea. I mean, it's one of those ideas that's actually served on a silver platter. It's about all of Courage's greatest enemies coming together to destroy Courage once and for all. Well, I'm hooked. Courage has some of the best bad guys in animation history. So, how are they going to bring them all together?
That stupid dog gets all the good stuff around here. I hate that dumb dog. And who are we going to destroy?
That stupid dog!
Oh my god. Courage just did to Eustace what SpongeBob did to Mr. Krabs in One Course Meal. He's actually trying to kill a beloved main character over such a minuscule reason. This is not at all what I was hoping for when I heard this plot idea. Okay, well, terrible reasoning aside, I'm sure they made some great picks as to who they should team up. Let's see, Cats, great starts. LeQuack, yeah, he's decent. Crack Rats, huh. Well, why not? You need a little humor. Edward G. Robinson Wait a minute, wasn't he Eustace? How'd he return? Is that the Wearmole? Really? And they got someone who's actually Eustace's villain. What the fuck? Well, seemingly, this doesn't seem like they picked the best villains. But actually, this could be a really good team-up. See, think about it. Cats and LeQuack are evil geniuses. I guarantee they can come up with something really devious. Edward G. Robinson Foot here can be like the muscles of the group. Crack Rat can be the comic relief. Black Puddle Queen is a seductive witch. They can definitely get use out of that. And Wearmole is the team mascot. Yeah, they can be like the Beedolls from the Powerpuff Girls. Alright, I'm pretty hyped now. So what's this great plan to defeat Courage? Kidnap Muriel. Alright, good. Cat's torturing her by... Well, not what I would have expected, but I'll let it slide, because it worked. Here comes Courage. Okay, let's see this plan. This has got to be great.
Let's play dodgeball.
When there's dodgeball, you know who to call. That thing flying at your face, a ball. When there's balls, you need to avoid. Winning strategy must be employed. We're the guys and girls who know how to throw.
Dodgeball. They landed on dodgeball. Well, I guess the issues with this episode are pretty clear now. It was nothing more than a giant tease. They actually had a decent teaming of bad guys that they could have done a lot with. But instead, they took this team up, gave it a forced reasoning, and made them so lame, they tried to defeat Courage with a damn gym game. What a giant letdown.
Oh, hello, Muriel. Oh, what did I do?
Now, for the record, the five episodes I just went over, they all have something in common, and that's that none of them are unwatchable. They're just disappointing, mediocre, and... okay episodes. However, we're about to get into the episodes that I actually find unwatchable and truly some of the worst episodes out there. Arnold betrays Iggy from Hey Arnold. This episode is actually the biggest reason I chose to do this list. After I made my top 10 best Hey Arnold episodes video, a lot of people asked me to give this episode a solo review, which is actually very difficult because the mysterious Mr. Enter and Phantom Strider already covered this episode and both went over the majority of what's wrong with it. And for the record, this is one of the two episodes that appears on both mine and Phantom Strider's list. Now for those of you who haven't heard about this episode, it's about Arnold catching a popular kid named Iggy wearing bunny pajamas, and he inadvertently lets it slip to Sid and Stinky. And I use inadvertently very strongly.
I mean, it wasn't like he was wearing bunny pajamas or something.
Boy, you're pulling my leg, right?
I didn't say anything.
Well, because Arnold told them about Iggy. Sid and Stinky tell the entire school, and Iggy becomes a laughingstock as a result. And he holds a grudge towards Arnold for months. And Arnold earns his trust back by embarrassing himself like he embarrassed Iggy, which is one of the hardest scenes in all of Hey Arnold to watch. Yeah, everything, and I mean everything, about this episode goes against what Hey Arnold normally did. See, I think the biggest issue with this episode is them using Arnold as the one who broke Iggy's trust. Because Arnold is legitimately incapable of doing something like that without seeming too out of character. Which I guess is why they made it look like an accident. And even that wasn't done right because it still doesn't make it look like it's Arnold's fault. This would have been easier to execute if they just cut out the middleman and made it Sid and Stinky who caught Iggy and then went around telling the whole school. And as a result, both of them have to make things right. Also, Sid and Stinky would have made a lot more sense because both of them have been portrayed as assholes before. So, you actually could buy them betraying someone's trust like that without it seeming out of character. And on top of that, because this doesn't completely feel like it's Arnold's fault, it makes Iggy look insufferable because he makes Arnold do all this shit by letting Arnold believe he'll forgive him, only to tell Arnold he'll never get his forgiveness. So, you never feel bad for Iggy like you're clearly supposed to. And that's a really, really bizarre fuck-up from the show. There's also a few more technical flaws, like Iggy never revealing why he was wearing bunny pajamas, and Arnold's grandpa behaving very out of character, that just push this episode further into infamy. There's also a common misconception with this episode that it was Iggy's last episode, because it was so bad, they just stopped using Iggy. But that's not true. Iggy actually appears in a few episodes after this. Hell, he even has a speaking role in the episode Gerald's Game, which came out two seasons after this one.
You're crazy, Arnold! You'll be a dungeon pawn! You'll have to devote the next 6 months of your life serving the king!
There's also another common rumor that Craig Bartlett, the creator of Hey Arnold, hates this episode as well, and that he made the staff behind this episode apologize. But Craig Bartlett himself said that wasn't true in an Instagram post. But that doesn't take anything away from how bad this episode is. It's still an episode that goes against everything that made Hey Arnold great. And in my opinion, it deserves every bit of backlash it gets. It's just a colossal fuck-up of an episode. Carl Weezer, Boy Genius from Jimmy Neutron. Absolutely hate this episode. You know what this episode is? It's the I'm with Stupid of Jimmy Neutron. This episode is about Carl's pen pal coming to visit him from Sweden, insert PewDiePie joke here, and his pen pal happens to be very attractive and seemingly very accomplished.
She's a teen model, tennis star, gymnast, masseuse, and ballet dancer.
However, Carl lied to her and told her he was a genius by putting his head on Jimmy's body when Jimmy was on missions. Well, to be fair, maybe Carl was there. He was just the one holding the camera. Now, Carl's intentions, I kind of understand. In the same way I understood SpongeBob offering to make himself look stupid so Patrick's parents wouldn't think ill of him. And just like I'm with Stupid, the biggest issue with this episode is that Carl acts fucking ungrateful and repulsive to Jimmy, who's the one doing him a favor.
Hi, I'm my dim-witted assistant. Take Elkie's bag and be quick about it, you supreme bonehead! This was all your fault! Way to go, dim-witted assistant! I had everything under control until you messed it up!
For the record, I never really hated Carl in this show. I mean, I found him obnoxious every now and then, but he never really got too far under my skin. But in this episode, I just despise him. His behavior is straight up unforgivable. Like, I understand trying to show off to a pretty girl, but Carl puts all of them in danger countless times, and whenever something happens, he instantly passes blame to Jimmy. And that's the entire episode. Carl tries to impress her, he fucks it up, and then yells at Jimmy after Jimmy saves their asses.
I know what button to push. I was just testing you. Dimwitted assistant, remember what I taught you about getting the hover car under control? You nincompoop! You must have put the wrong fuel in my hover car!
Anyway, it turns out Carl's pen pal was lying about all of her accomplishments, and Carl reveals he lied as well. And they walk off happily ever after. And no, Carl never apologizes to Jimmy, never learns a lesson, he just gets away with being an asshole while Jimmy is left suffering. I guess the intent of this episode was to say, you know, don't lie, be yourself, all that good cliched bullshit. But this was not the right way to handle it. This episode just straight up rewards Carl for lying and being a complete asshole the whole episode, and it's just a really rough watch. And you know what's weird? The episode almost got this right, because at first, his pen pal didn't believe him when he said he was lying.
No, Carl, don't try to make me feel better with lies.
But I...
That would have been a much more tolerable ending. If she said, I can't be with you because you're too smart for me, and left Carl there crying, and he reevaluated everything he did and apologized, saying he'll never lie or treat his friends that way again, it would have at least been a passable episode. But instead, it's one of the worst episodes to ever come out of Jimmy Neutron. You know what? I think I'm with Stupid was a lot better than this episode. At least that one had more decent comedy, and the first half wasn't too insufferable. So I think that says enough about this episode.
Come, let me kiss you so many times, nerd boy!
What the?
It's a Wishful Life from Fairly OddParents. This is the other episode that Phantom Strider put on his list, and it's the Fairly OddParents episode I've gotten the most requests to take a look at. And boy, am I not surprised by that. This is one of the few episodes that actually hurt me to watch. And while the Fairly OddParents has gone downhill as of recently, this episode came when they were still in their prime. Now, what makes this episode so hated is that it's about Timmy just wanting to do good deeds, and everyone treats his attempt so horribly that he wishes he was never born to see how they'd do without him. And everyone is actually happy without him.
I've come to show you how horrible the world is without you.
What are you talking about? My parents' lives are great!
I know, I was being sarcastic!
And there's just so many things that don't make sense in this episode. Timmy's parents are happy because they, for some reason, have a daughter who's successful. AJ's in college and has hair. I assume this hints that Timmy was so hard to be friends with that it caused AJ a great deal of stress and he went bald at age 10 as a result. Vicky isn't babysitting anymore and is instead working for Dr. Bender, even though I don't think Timmy was the only kid she babysat, so I don't see why she'd need another job. And Cosmo and Wanda are happy because they're Chester's godparents, and he does good deeds. You know, kinda like what Timmy was doing this whole episode. And he also wants to make the world a better place. I'm sure that turns out well. They also make this indirect comment that comes right the fuck out of nowhere.
Oh, and no stupid pink hat to ruin his hair!
That's literally just thrown into shit more on Timmy. And what's probably most insulting is that this episode seems to hint that Timmy made everyone's lives miserable because he only did good deeds when he wanted appreciation.
You made your stupid wish because you felt unappreciated, right?
Yeah, because no one noticed all my good deeds.
You are not supposed to do good deeds because they will get you noticed. You are supposed to do them because they are the right thing to do.
Okay, first of all, Timmy seems to be doing good deeds for the same reason Chester is in this episode. Yet, Chester is praised for it. Second, if these people constantly react the way they do when Timmy does something nice, then I don't blame him for not doing good deeds for them. They all act like spoiled, rotten pieces of crap when Timmy does something nice. Timmy's teacher is pissed at him for working on the set for the play all by himself because the color schemes are mostly the same as what he wanted, but not 100% what he wanted. He gives AJ a computer that probably cost him his soul, only for AJ to destroy it because a newer model came out seconds before Timmy gave it to him. and his parents in one of the most forced and poorly executed jokes ever don't like Timmy fixing up their yard because they wanted to win a Worst Backyard Ever award. Yeah, be honest. Would you keep doing good deeds for people who treated them like this? And lastly, it's not selfish to do good deeds just for a little admiration. Hell, if someone came to mow my lawn and asked me to pay them in thank yous and compliments, I'd say that's a pretty damn good deal. So, it's just fucked up that they tried to imply that Timmy was the one being selfish. God, this episode sucks. Imposters Home for, Make 'em Up Pals from Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends. God, that was a long title. Okay, first of all, I'm kind of stretching this a bit, because Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends is kind of a hit or miss show, but I personally always enjoyed it. Well, I wasn't a big fan of Blue, or Mr. Harriman for that matter, but I always enjoyed everyone else, and it made for some decent humor. Now, people seem to go back and forth on which episode is worse, this or Everyone Knows It's Bendy. In fact, these episodes have very similar flaws. But I think this one is a bit worse, and I'll explain why at the end. In this episode, after Blue causes a big mess after disobeying Frankie, Mr. Harriman instantly blames her by accusing her of not doing her work and threatens to keep her from a concert she wants to attend. So Frankie is forced to clean this entire mess that Blue made, and then a teenager wearing a fucking clown nose and clown tie, who calls himself Goofball, shows up and says he's an imaginary friend. Or, as he calls them,
yeah, I'm one of those, imaginatory guys. I'm one of them, make-em-up pals.
Yeah, this episode goes heavily overboard trying to imply that this guy is a fraud that's just trying to get free food from Foster's. However, only Frankie is the one who sees it, and everyone else believes he's an imaginary friend. And this fucking character puts Frankie through hell. He makes her do his laundry, help him with his homework, eats all the food, resulting in her having to buy more food with her own money, and when Frankie gets back from doing this, these fuckers ordered pizza, and they make Frankie pay for that too. Oh, and the funny thing is, Goofball is nowhere near the worst character in this episode. No. It's Mr. fucking Harriman who's the worst. This guy's behavior towards Frankie is more appalling than his behavior in Everyone Knows It's Bendy.
Don't worry, I'll just order some takeout.
No, that won't do. This is Goofball's first night with us, and he deserves a home-cooked meal. Luckily, Goofball keenly suggested we order in, and thanks to him, our bellies will be filled with vital nourishment.
You know, I really do question if Mr. Harriman is just a sexist. I mean, no head of house can be this stupid. This guy will literally go out of his way to punish Frankie, no matter what, and he proves that at the end of this episode. Remember this concert Frankie's been wanting to go to? The one she's been putting herself through hell just to attend? Well, fucking Goofball gets Frankie into trouble again, and Mr. Harriman bans her from attending the concert and won't listen to anything she has to say. So Frankie is forced to clean the entire house, and fucking Goofball goes to the concert with the other main characters and boasts about it to her. And she, of course, snaps and rips his nose off. But it turns out, this bastard actually is an imaginary friend. Yeah, I didn't see that coming at all. You only tried to prove he wasn't the whole goddamn episode, to where it was kinda clear that was gonna be the twist. But hey, that was a great twist. Good on ya. And they actually try to make everything Frankie went through all okay. With this stupid line.
I really am sorry.
Hey, no worries, Franny. You took real good care of me.
That doesn't save this episode. This was an entire episode of watching someone get tortured for no reason. How is that one line supposed to make everything okay? Mr. Harriman doesn't learn anything. Goofball gets away with everything he did. And here's why I think this episode is a bit worse than Everyone Knows It's Bendy. Everyone Knows It's Bendy was supposed to be a 22-minute long episode, but it got shortened up and a lot of key plot points got taken out. So, that episode might have had potential to have been a little bit better. As for this episode, it actually is 22 minutes. This episode was meant to be this mean-spirited. It's just an overall disgusting episode. What could possibly be worse? Well, American Fung from American Dad. Well, it's been nothing but kid shows so far, so now it's time for an adult show, and American Dad is a personal favorite of mine. While I don't think it's as funny as Family Guy can be, I think the writing is usually a lot better and a lot more well thought out. That being said, American Dad does have its moments where it can get pretty damn fucked up, and this is by far the most fucked up they ever got. This episode is about Stan forgetting his and Francine's anniversary, and to keep her from finding out, he has her locked away in a mental institution, class act, so he can go get her a really nice anniversary gift. Then, he forgets the anniversary again, and for some reason, he turns into a stereotypical teenage girl. Oh, just play it with this music. We all know this is what you mean. And girls, they wanna have fun. Oh, girls just wanna have fun. Well, Stan gets told his wife is getting released and realizes he forgot their anniversary again. And then while picking her up, she has a breakdown and gets sent back in. And Stan forgets again that it was their anniversary.
Oh my god, I totally ruined this birthday?
Yeah, get the same joke in there as much as possible. Stan gets told he's the reason Francine went crazy and gets himself admitted to go break Francine out. And just, everything that happens here is just, well, it's some of the most offensive humor American Dad has ever done. It consists of nothing but mental and physical abuse of handicapped people. And yeah, I get it, dark humor, ha ha ha. But this is some shitty-ass dark humor, because it's just going to the least common denominator. It's making fun of mentally handicapped people in a schoolyard bully kind of way to where it just looks pathetic. Like, really? You couldn't think of better jokes than hitting handicapped people, talking to them like they're children, using the long-overused nutshot gags, and to cap it all off, lobotomization.
My apologies, but a hospital can't allow their violent patients to run about freely.
And what does that mean?
A better life through lobotomies.
Okay, well, truth be told, I give them some props for trying to think outside the box with lobotomization. I'm actually very shocked they went with something that's been banned for decades. But that was still a very bad choice. And yes, it's absolutely cringeworthy to watch this gag. Oh, and there's a secondary plot about this guy named Fung Hua or something else equally as stereotypical, whose purpose is to, I don't even know, I guess he's making fun of Japanese comedy or Japanese television. I guess Japanese television is bombarded with terrible and forced-in ads. Truth be told, I know nothing about Japanese television, so I can't even begin to analyze it. From my perspective, it's just a boring, senseless, time filler of a secondary plot, along with one of the worst main plots you'll ever see. If this was a Family Guy episode, it'd be a top 10, maybe top 5, worst Family Guy episode in my opinion. And trust me, that's saying something. It's really one of the most pathetic, boring, and downright unwatchable episodes of any show I've ever seen. Just shame on you, American Dad!
So, did you like the episode? If you do or not do, I not really care anymore.